A slab of width d and dielectric constant k is inserted a distance x into the space between the square parallel plates of side L of a capacitor as shown in the figure. We are then asked to determine, as a function of this distance x, the capacitance, the energy stored at a voltage V0, and the force exerted on the slab. To solve this problem requires that we actually treat this device as not a single capacitor with an inconsistent interior, but rather we treat this capacitor as two capacitors. One capacitor is filled with a dielectric material of constant K, and the other capacitor is filled with air, as indicated by the line X. We need to determine two different things. First, what would be the capacitance of any capacitor? As we remember from the previous problem, the capacitance of any capacitor will be given by epsilon naught area over distance d. In the problem at hand, because we have two capacitors, if we look carefully, each one of them will have the same distance d. Epsilon naught is of course a constant, but depending upon how far we insert the dielectric material in between, the areas of each capacitor will vary. Maybe they're 50-50 of the original area, maybe they're 80-20, maybe they're 90-10. All of this depends upon the size of X as compared to L. The second key piece of information necessary to solve this problem is to decide whether these two capacitors have been connected in parallel or in series. Dividing the picture in our mind at the blue dashed line, but not losing the electrical contacts, we can see that the top plate of the two capacitors are connected to each other, as well as the bottom plate. In this case, these capacitors are connected in parallel, and so we'll be able to say that the C total is going to be C1 plus C2, and therefore, since each capacitor has an epsilon naught area over D, we have the formula shown here where the two areas are different, but as we mentioned before, D is the same. Oh no! We did it again! We forgot about the dielectric! That's okay. We know what to do. Anytime you deal with a dielectric, you simply need to make the replacement epsilon naught becomes K epsilon naught. I'm going to call capacitor 2, the one on the right, and therefore the epsilon naught in that original formula is not correct. That one should be replaced by K epsilon naught. And now we have the correct total capacitance for one air capacitor and one other that is filled with a dielectric. The only thing we'll need to do to get the two answers is to specify the values of the two different areas, A1 and A2, and substitute these into the previous formula. Each of these capacitors has a length L along one side, but the other side they don't have L. The capacitor to the left has a length of L minus X, while the capacitor on the right merely has a length of X. Substituting these into the previous formula for the total capacitance and also factoring out the epsilon naught over D, we're left with the following simple formula. Capacitance total is epsilon naught over D times the complicated quantity in parentheses. We can simplify this quantity a little bit by distributing the L in the first term and combining things, giving us a slightly simpler result as follows. Total capacitance is epsilon naught over D times the quantity L squared plus K minus 1 LX. Whenever we come up with a complicated formula like this, it's a good idea to consider the formula in a couple of limits to see whether it makes sense. First, we notice that if the dielectric material had a dielectric constant K of 1, meaning it's just like air, this formula reduces to capacitance total is epsilon naught L squared over D, just what we would have expected if we never had any dielectric. Similarly, if X were 0, the second term would drop out entirely, giving us once again the formula for the capacitance of the capacitor we started the problem with. And finally, the most interesting case, if X were equal to L, meaning that we had fully inserted this dielectric in the capacitor, then the total capacitance would be equal to K epsilon naught L squared over D, which is what one expects for a single capacitor with dielectric filling its entire interior. While these three calculations are not necessary to get the answer that the problem asks for, they're nonetheless reassuring that what we have written down as a mathematical formula at least makes sense. And in this case, it's actually right too. Part B of the problem asks us to find the energy stored if the potential difference is V0. We recognize that the potential energy stored in a capacitor is not equal to Q times V. That's what you get for placing one charge into a single value of voltage, but in fact it is half Q total times V final, with the reason for the half being as follows. The first charge to arrive in the capacitor arrives under V equals zero. The last charge to arrive on the capacitor arrives at V equals V final. On average, a typical charge arrived with only half of V final, and so this is the proper averaging of QV over the insertion period as the capacitor's charge goes from zero to Q total and the capacitor's voltage goes from zero to V final. Because we know that V equals Q over C, two other formulations of this same expression can be made. These are 1/2 charge squared over capacitance and 1/2 capacitance times voltage squared. Simply because of the set of things that we do know at this point, the third of these expressions is the easiest one to calculate, in that we can take our previous expression for the capacitance and simply multiply by 1/2 V0 squared, yielding us a result for the potential energy, which says that the potential energy is 1/2 epsilon naught over D, V0 squared, times the same quantity as in our capacitance formula, L squared plus K minus 1 Lx. The last part of the problem may seem bizarre and out of place. What is the force acting on the dielectric? All we know is the potential energy as a function of where you've placed the dielectric. But if you understand potential energy, you recognize the potential energy is always related to force. Last semester, we generated a definition that said a change in potential energy was related to minus the line integral of force times distance. This is simply a fancy way of writing work equals force times distance. We knew this. This semester, because our mathematics is a little more sophisticated, we are able to write the reverse relation, telling us that force is equal to negative the gradient of potential energy. In that case, the force will have an x component, which is negative the partial derivative of potential energy with respect to x, a y component, which is negative the partial derivative with respect to y, and a z component, which is negative the partial derivative with respect to z. Clearly, since our formula only depends upon x, there will only be a force in the x direction. Furthermore, since we're asked to find the magnitude of the force on the slab of dielectric, we don't even have to care about the minus sign. All we've got to do is take a derivative and get things correct. Examining our expression very carefully, inside the parentheses is a constant L squared and also a function of x. In the process of taking a derivative, constants drop out, so we will find that the magnitude of f sub x is related only to the derivative of the second term. There's simply an x at the end, so the derivative of something times x is the something, and the something is as follows. 1/2 epsilon naught over d, voltage squared, times dielectric constant minus 1, times the length. And that is the force that pulls the dielectric into the capacitor, and the reason it pulls the dielectric in is that the further in the dielectric goes, the smaller is the potential energy, and all systems evolve towards the lowest potential energy state. And that's the solution to the partly filled capacitor problem.